The staff of K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network is proud to announce that our very own Rowdy Rick Robinson has been selected as one of the top conservative talk show hosts in the nation for his program, America Off the Rails. Again, congratulations to Rowdy Rick Robinson for a job well done and another reason to stay connected to K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.
Keep this promise to the American people. If you like your doctor, you will be able to keep your doctor, period. If you like your health care plan, you will be able to keep your health care plan, period.
This is the most transparent administration in history. Not even a smidgen of corruption.
Fact is, we had four dead Americans. What difference at this point does it make?
If you got a business, you didn't build that.
Welcome to the face of the new democracy. Don't expect just to admit a mistake. We're paying off election debts to those on the take. Attorney General's lying even while...
It's time to hear the truth about America's biggest challenges. You're listening to America Off the Rails with your host, Rick Robinson.
Well, good afternoon, good evening, good morning, wherever you might be. I am Rick Robinson. This is America Off the Rails. And as you can tell from the title, we're going to do a little bit of a recap on the State of the Union. I may save that until later in the show. There are a few other things that I definitely wanted to touch on. Now, one of the things I wanted to let you know is I did plan on, before the airing of the show, I was actually going to have a companion article up on freepressok.com. Ran into a bit of a time crunch, so that will be available later this evening, so feel free to check that out as well. Also, as soon as this show ends, we will go into According to Me with Jason DeWilkins. That is regularly run on the 405 and run as a syndicated broadcast here. And then as soon as that show ends, we will go into the Vigilant Liberty Radio Group with the Spark Radio Network production show, Liberty Unfiltered, hosted by Steve Long. Then, of course, we'll finish off the political part of the night with... Liz Harrison with the Liz Harrison Radio Show, also a Vigilant Liberty Radio production. That one is solely in-house for them. And then we will move on to the Late Night in the Midlands crew. I want to give a big shout-out to Michael Vera. If you missed it last night, you can catch it here as a podcast on K98Talk.com. He did give a tribute to a longtime fan of the show and someone who had actually helped him with setting up some of the chat room stuff and helped him book a few guests from time to time, and was honestly, just from listening to him talk, kind of instrumental in helping him make a few decisions. Sadly, that gentleman passed, so they did do a little bit of a tribute for him last night. So if you missed that, make sure you go back and check it out. I did manage to catch the last few minutes of that show last night, and I thought it was kind of cool. Okay. You know, I said I was going to wait till maybe the last half of the show, but I just can't do it. There's so many things to talk about with the State of the Union, so I think we're just going to go ahead and change gears, because I've been trying to start maybe getting it to the point where I'm saving the stuff that I think you guys are really going to want to hear till the last part of the show, but I don't know, I can't do it. There are so many other things I could talk about. You know what, maybe I will. I think I'll wait till after the break, because there are a couple of things that have come up, and I had actually planned on... I just remembered what it was I was going to do, but I didn't do it. For those of you who were watching the playoff game with the Pats, of course, it's now been confirmed that several of the balls, I think it was actually 11 out of 12 of the balls that they used, were underinflated by about 2 pounds. Now, the thing about this, and the thing you need to keep in mind, is this was confirmed... Or these balls were approved by the referees, so I don't know if maybe they'd managed to do something after the fact. And I actually heard it on the way into work today on one of the local stations here that apparently whoever the ref was in charge of that is also a rather big-time person inside the Big 12 conference. So there was some sports talk going on, and these guys were like, we don't really think this ref could have possibly let something like that slide without noticing it. And then on the drive home today, of course, it was part of the news again. And what I heard over and over again was, you know, you have to take into account that when it's cold, things lose air. The thing about that is they take that into account if you stop and think about it. That's why by the guidelines, each ball is supposed to be inflated a minimum of 12 pounds, maximum of 13 pounds. That takes into account the fact that normally the balls will lose probably somewhere about a pound of air during an average game, depending on the temperature outside. And that's a rather generous estimate. So the fact that each one of these balls could have been underinflated by as much as 2 pounds, and it was 99% of the balls in play, you know, I see it both ways, because everybody's talking about, well, you know, this isn't the, well, it wasn't a three-point game, and it wasn't decided by a field goal, or it wasn't decided by a missed catch, it was a blowout. But the biggest thing that I'm trying to get across to everybody is maybe the reason it was a blowout was because the quarterback was having an easier time throwing the ball and the players were having an easier time catching the ball on the team that had the lower inflated balls. And for those of you who were wondering what I had considered doing during most of this segment is playing AC/DC Big Balls. Sadly, I had forgotten that I wanted to do that until right before we went on air. And according to producer, we don't have that clip available. So much for best laid plans of mice and men. Okay, so, I mean, I guess my biggest thing with that is, you know, I wonder if we should start a petition to maybe have the Patriots change their name. Especially since Bill Belichick's nickname is Bill Belichick. You know, it concerns me that a football team named the Patriots continues to do scandalous crap and nobody seems to care. I mean, and now they're talking about some big-time fines or possibly a sanction or loss of a draft pick. What the hell do they care? They may or may not get a Super Bowl ring, and all they had to do was deflate 11 of their 12 balls. I'm kind of thinking, you know, if you're going to reward bad behavior, what are you teaching them? It's all right, they'll sanction us, we'll get by it, but hey, we got the Super Bowl ring, baby. You know, I've never liked the Patriots. This is coming from a conservative. You'd figure I'd be all over a team named the Patriots. I just never really have much cared for them. But to be honest, I didn't really much care for professional football until I moved to Seattle. I spent quite a bit of my teenage years in Seattle. And of course, when I was in Seattle, nobody went to see the Seahawks play. They went to see who the Seahawks were playing. But that was during the Kingdom days. From what I saw on TV the other night, I'm pretty sure that structure's long been forgotten. But some of my best teenage memories are actually going to football games in person, because I never really got much out of it on TV. It was, you know, I mean, I was a kid. It was pre the yellow line. And, you know, when you're not into sports, it's kind of really hard to keep up with what's going on. They did eventually make it a lot easier, you know, thanks to the yellow lines and the clocks and everything else that you have on TV. So I do get into the playoff games. I don't much watch the regular season stuff that often. But I have to say, again, you know, they're talking about, what, some sort of sanctions? Maybe they're going to lose a draft pick? And these guys, because of this, that may be one of the primary reasons they're going to the Super Bowl. Why do they care if they lose a draft pick if they're the Super Bowl champions? So I have to say, not only am I going to be rooting for Seattle because of the fact that I used to live there, and honestly, as time goes on, I've found myself kind of becoming more and more of a Seattle fan, because back in the day, even when I lived in Seattle, I was a Cowboys fan. But I really, as I get older and I see Jerry Jones, the more I see Jerry Jones, the more I see the old rich guy from The Simpsons. And I'm just not sure I can keep rooting for the old rich guy from The Simpsons. So I will be rooting for the underdog, folks, because one, I used to live there, and because two, as far as I'm concerned, people who cheated to get there don't deserve to be there. So that's my take on the Patriots and the underinflated balls fiasco, or as they are calling it, actually, what were they calling it? Football gate or some crap like that? I don't know. Anyway, like I said, I'm not really up on too much of the sports stuff. I'm a political junkie and a sci-fi nerd. We've had this conversation before. But I did want to at least weigh in on that. So I do hope that since it has been determined that they may or may not have, or that they were using underinflated balls, and that from looking at it and from the law of averages, it's rather unlikely that 11 out of the 12 would have been below normal by that much, just from normal wear and tear and temperature. So I'm pretty sure they got caught being shady. So, way to go, Pats. Way to put one over on the guys, you know. I mean, granted, the Colts didn't necessarily come to play, so I guess it really doesn't matter anyway. But hey, what do I know? Alright, so another thing that's been kind of brought to my attention through Twitter, and I don't know if you guys know about this, and I tried to talk about this a little bit on Finding Common Ground this last weekend, but we had some technical issues, so I haven't actually been able to get that show posted. It went out live if you were paying attention, but the co-host was having some internet issues, so he kept dropping in and out, and it was affecting the entire feed. So that one will kind of go the way of File 13, and we will try again this week. Something that keeps being brought to my attention, and something I honestly didn't know existed, and I figure we'll talk about this before we take our first break, because the State of the Union stuff may take just a little bit longer than the usual 30 minutes. But are you aware, because all we ever really seem to hear about in the media is the fact of how rough Sharia law is for women, and I will give you that. But the one thing that I'd never really even taken into account, because you never hear about it, is the fact that there are just as many instances where Sharia law is hard on men. I mean, if you've heard of this before, feel free to shoot me an email or shoot me a tweet. You can tweet me at @_R_OKC. You can shoot me an email at Ricky@thesparkradionetwork.com. But I gotta admit, other than a couple of stories that I've been tweeted by a certain person who seems to think that everyone who has this female-centric view of how bad everything is for women through Sharia law is being rather unkind, I personally seem to think that person is kind of attacking the wrong people, because I think that they are basically attacking people that could be their allies, because while things are bad for the male counterparts, you can't honestly say they're as bad for the male counterparts as they are for women. If you're trying to say that, then you're being dishonest with not only yourself, but with those that you're trying to plead your case to. But the simple fact of the matter is, and I didn't know this because, like I said, it's never really come up. There are times, if the charge of adultery can be confirmed, of course, in Sharia law, it has to be, I believe, it's either 4 or 5 male witnesses have to confirm it. But if it's confirmed, it's not only the woman who's stoned to death. Sometimes the woman is stoned to death, whether the charge can be confirmed or not, because at that point it's basically considered adultery. But there are even times when even after the charge is confirmed or denied, I'm sorry, it's not if it's confirmed, it's if it's denied, then the adultering couple, if it's deemed that it wasn't a rape situation, can actually be stoned to death. Not just the woman, but the man. So, I mean, this is one of the things that I keep asking everybody about over and over and over again. Is this the type of religious freedom that we need? Because all we are doing is giving these people the freedom they need to be able to come in here and basically decide they want Sharia law. If you don't think that's what a lot of them are going to try to do, just look at Europe. Look at France. They have Sharia law zones. They have no-go zones. When are we going to make sure that our freedoms come first? I understand if you look at the libertarian crowd, they're like, freedom should belong to everybody. I don't necessarily agree with that, because I don't want the people that want to kill me to have the same freedoms that I do. Otherwise, they might be able to proceed to do exactly what it is they say they want to do, which is wipe us off of the face of the earth. Is it my God-given right to restrict their freedoms? No, hell no, but it's my God-given right to be able to protect myself. And if I have to be, if I have to do that by restricting their movements, then I'm sorry, I may or may not be okay with that, but it is going to be on a case-by-case basis. Bring this up, again, because, you know, a couple things we've talked about over the week, and I just kind of want to keep that coming in as the recurring theme other than the main topics each week, or each show, and for this one, of course, it will be the State of the Union again, is simple fact of the matter is there are things that are going on that we're never going to know about. One of them is the fact that, or I'm sure there's more to it than even I know, but I do know for a fact that Egypt and the United Arab Emirate have been trying to warn the American people about the Council for American Islamic Relations for a very long time, because apparently that organization has ties to the Muslim Brotherhood. Now, you want to get even more scary with that? Not only do they have ties to the Muslim Brotherhood, they have regular meetings with the White House. I mean, am I not supposed to take people that are in that region of the world and tell me point blank these people are terrorists? Are we not supposed to take them at their words any longer? All because we're trying to be the kinder, gentler United States? And yeah, I'm starting to drift back towards State of the Union, but part of it that I wanted to talk about that doesn't fit into my main topic is the fact that not one time did he mention Al-Qaeda. Or ISIS. Or ISIL. He basically said, we stand united to defend against terrorism wherever it may occur, including Paris. Really? You're so united with the people of Paris, you couldn't even send Holder, who was in Paris, to represent our country during the march. Now, I understand, and I get it, there are a lot of folks that are talking about why aren't we getting credit for the fact that we're the ones actually bombing these people while the rest of the world gets to march in solidarity, and it's basically just one of those things where it looks really good and it's a photo op. The simple fact of the matter is we are the leaders of the free world. Obama, Biden, that's you. One of you should have been there. If you couldn't get there, you should have made sure Holder was going to be there. If you couldn't do that, then you should have reached out to possibly President Clinton. I mean, Lord knows the Bush family's probably not going to be traveling right now. But you could have reached out to President Clinton and said, hey, I'm too busy watching football. I've still got Biden chained up in the basement. I'm sorry. It's the attic. Yeah, that's where we keep him. He's in the attic. And, you know, Holder's too busy, you know, going through the what's usually long lines like the Louvre and things like that. Yeah, he's in there getting some pictures taken, hanging out with, getting a selfie taken with the Mona Lisa picture, getting up to the top of the Eiffel Tower. So yeah, he's too busy to make it. And I've got some football I need to watch. And you know, we don't really want to turn crazy Uncle Joe loose. So hey, Billy boy, can you do me a solid? Did you even bother to make that phone call? No. What you decided would be acceptable was to phone one in for the team. Then you threw the Secret Service under the bus and said, well, the reason we didn't go was because we had security concerns. Funny thing is, your active duty Secret Service personnel, they sure can't say anything because that breaks protocol. But I've heard from plenty of people that used to do Secret Service work that are like, yeah, he's full of crap. So, thanks for reminding everybody just exactly how full of crap you are. Which is pretty much what he did all night last night. But we'll get to that again here in just a little bit, because it's not quite break time yet, and I'm not done ranting for the moment, so. Okay, so, we didn't send Holder, we didn't send Biden, we didn't send Obama, we didn't send Mrs. Obama, we didn't send Hillary Clinton. The former First Lady would have worked by protocol. It would have been all right to do that. No, we didn't do any of that. Obama stayed home and watched football. Was it worth it? I mean, come on. You didn't even do your normal thing and go out and play a round of golf. You just didn't ask, screw it. I'm going to stay home and watch football. France is on their own. Viva la freedom fries. I mean, come on. I could have possibly understood it if the Bush-Cheney White House was still in power. Because Lord knows, we didn't even... We like, hated the French during that time frame. We even changed French toast to freedom toast. And French fries to freedom fries. Never mind the fact that neither one of those things actually came from the country of France. America. But, I mean, come on. You know, could you maybe not, you know, phone a friend? Oh, wait, I'm sorry. I forgot. You really don't have those, do you? Even the people that used to work with you in the Chicago and I'm sorry, in the Chicago area, in the Illinois legislature, basically used to say that you weren't a team player then. I'd like to know where all these voices were before you got elected, but they sure are liking to come out of the woodworks now. All right, so at this point, we are going to get to the point where we are about to have to take a commercial break, because I do need to go ahead and get a few things situated while we get things ready to move on to the State of the Union address last night, and it's in a little bit more of a full measure. So bear with me for just a moment while I get a few things situated, and then we will be ready to go.
Please come now, I think I'm falling, holding on to all I think is safe. Seems I found a road to nowhere, and I'm trying to escape.
This is Misty, owner of Wax It Studio in Edmond, Oklahoma, and I'm here to talk to you about a skincare product called Theramedics. Theramedics has a wonderful line of products from anti-aging to hyperpigmentations all the way to acne. In fact, everyone at some point in our lives is affected by acne. Acne can cause a great deal of embarrassment and anxiety. And in order to prevent and help other people, I have tapped into this wonderful product called Theramedics. Visit my website at www.prettyskindeep.com. Again, that's www.prettyskindeep.com.
You liked him on Facebook. You followed him on Twitter. The Conservative Curmudgeon Radio Show, a talk show host who's not afraid to say what's on his mind. A live, in-your-ears kind of program. Coming to a computer near you, starting in January, every Thursday evening at 8 p.m. Eastern and 7 Central. Brought to you by the Spark Radio Network and K98Talk.com.
Hi everybody, this is Denny C. on behalf of Common Ground Media and The Family Factor. I'd like you to pay attention to the commercial you're about to be listening to, as my nephew has something called cystic fibrosis, and we'd like you to help by giving to those with this disease. You can give by going to www.cff.org. Again, that is cystic fibrosis at www.cff.org. So thank you, and please listen to the commercial.
Cystic fibrosis is a disease that attacks the digestive system and slowly shuts down the lungs. The mucus in everyone else's lungs is more watery, so you guys can clear it easier. But when it comes to my lung, the mucus is very syrupy. I've been doing my treatments every day of my life, so to me it's just one of those things that are normal. My name is Brian Warnicki, and I've been living with cystic fibrosis for 15 years. It feels like I'm breathing through a straw. Whenever I try to breathe hard, it hurts. I want to make the most out of my life and have as much fun as I possibly can, and my biggest fear is not being able to do that.
Hope that you spend your days, but they all add up.
I'll say
Denny C. Please help my nephew and others at www.cff.org. Again, that's www.cff.org.
Hi, I'm Steve Long of Liberty Unfiltered. If you're tired of hearing the same Republican and Democrat banter from the mainstream media, join me on Wednesday nights at 9, 8 Central, as I crawl out of the cesspool of partisan politics and bring the fight for freedom against the advocates of big government to the masses.
We're back. We're live. This is Rick Robinson. You are listening to America Off the Rails, and we're going to kick right back off with some more takes on the State of the Union. For those of you who missed it last night, I did live tweet during the entire thing, so you can always go back and check out some of the interesting things. I got in on a few topics from a couple of other hosts that I frequent and hang around with on Twitter. Also had some stuff of my own to say. Also, of course, when this show concludes, I will be publishing a companion article that I wrote last evening and just hadn't had a chance to get it put up on freepressok.com yet. So feel free to check that out later as well. Now, to kind of sum up the whole State of the Union speech, let me just kind of let you know what I think here. You ready for it? You sure you're ready? Just asking. Sometimes people don't like it when I let the ideas out of this crazy head of mine, but we're going to do it anyway. So this sums up the entire State of the Union in about 30 seconds. See, the title makes a little bit of sense now if you're a nerd like I am anyway. Okay, so let me try to put this into perspective for you. As far as I'm concerned, the State of the Union last night was a joke. The State of the Union was basically what's a nice way to put it? A grandiose tale of revisionist history not seen since the likes of Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure. Yeah, again, the reason why we played that little bit of a ditty there. You know, this one. Yeah, this thing. He took everything that he said was never going to work, that worked in spite of him, and took credit for it. Did a few victory laps, gave some veto threats, basically made an ass out of himself at one point when he was talking about how he didn't have any other campaigns to run, which was a bald-faced lie, because he was sending out contributor emails the entire night, because the State of the Union last night kicked off the 2016 Democratic election campaign. And while he may not be the one running, he's still helping to illustrate and orchestrate the campaigns. So yet another lie. So while everybody on the liberal side of everything was cheering and screaming and buying everything he said hook, line, and sinker and lapping up the Kool-Aid like it was the best thing since sliced bread, I'm sitting back here the entire time going, okay, great idea. How are we going to pay for this crap? We're already $18 trillion in debt.
Did you bother to bring that up? You know, not to mention the fact that you yourself, president number 44, yeah, you, that guy, up there at the desk, telling everybody what a great job you've done, patting yourself on the back. Did you bother to tell them how you've spent more than every other president in history combined? No, you decided that wasn't a good idea, did you? Instead, you decided to tell them how you were going to rob from the rich and give to the poor. Ladies and gentlemen, might I present the President of the United States, Robin Hood. And people bought it. They buy this crap, and some of it's because we're so desperate for something to work that we don't even care which side it comes from anymore. We just want to get back to being Americans again. We want the economy to work. We want to be able to go to work and come home. We don't want to have to worry about all of this. Is somebody going to try to kill us in our sleep? Why is our border wide open? Why do all these people want to kill us? Nobody wants to think about that on a regular basis, not on a day-to-day. Case in point was a caller we took last night, who I know is not an Obama supporter, but he liked the State of the Union speech because he felt like, and we talked about it, that, you know, Obama's a guy that could sell ice cubes to Eskimos if he had to. So the fact that he came out and blew sunshine and lollipops and rainbows and unicorns all over the crowd last night, and everybody lapped it up. Look at what happened today with the stock market. Is it a false positive reaction? Probably. Are we going to get lulled back into complacency and wind up being the Titanic headed for that iceberg that nobody's paying attention to? Yeah, sure we are. Why do you think they had the band start playing? Let that sink in for a second. Go back and watch the movie. When things really got bad, even before they made the announcement, before they informed everybody, they had the musicians start playing again because they wanted people to be distracted. That's what that was last night. That was a distraction. And too many of you bought it hook, line, and sinker. I mean, I say too many of you, but at last count, barely anybody was paying attention to the speech. Other than those of us that are political junkies, most everybody else was more pissed off that their regular TV shows weren't on. I mean, is that the state of the country that we find ourselves in now today? Is we're more worried about what's on TV and more worried about being able to watch, well, I was going to say Honey Boo Boo, but thank God that show is finally over. We're going to keep watching the Kardashians or, what is that new one on USA? I haven't actually watched it yet. Chrisley? I've seen the previews for that show, or the commercial breaks for that show. I got to say, that dude weirds me out. Just a little. But yeah, I mean, you know, just, I mean, what are we going to do? Because we're so desperate for something, for anything to work, that when he tells us, hey, because of the things that I've done here, now look at the economy. Really, let's take a really hard, long look at the economy, because weren't you the one that said we can't drill our way into prosperity? So, are gas prices lower now because of you or in spite of you? I know the answer. Do you, Mr. President? Now, let's move on to some of the things that he was talking about. Let's be really honest for a second. He's talking about some form of government-funded daycare. Anybody see what happened when we started trying to move into government-funded healthcare? Wasn't that supposed to save you money? When he first started bringing that out, wasn't that supposed to save the average American family $2,500 a year? I mean, granted, that's not a ton of money. But hey, it's not bad. That's what, about $200 a month? $225 a month? Instead, now it's costing you almost $400 a month for the same thing that he told you was going to save you money? On average? I talk to people every day, people that work where I work that have taken supervisory positions. And now that they have more income, of course, they have to pay more for their insurance. And now they're required to be on the insurance, so now it costs even more because it's compulsory now. This is what happens when you make things compulsory. This is what happens when the government gets in the middle of everything. So please, for the love of God, before you buy into the sunshine, the lollipops, the roses, and all of the good stuff that he blew out to the crowd last night, let's stop and think for a second. Do you want the same government that basically drove NASA almost into lack of funding to the point where we're now dependent on Russian technology to make sure that our astronauts are taken care of in the space station? The same government who cannot run a simple thing like the post office. I mean, come on, FedEx can do it. I was going to say UPS can do it, but we've had some issues with Brown lately at my wife's job, so not going Brown anymore. Just saying. I mean, they can't even run the post office. And one of the things I tried to point out last night when I tried to bring this up with the caller was they couldn't even make sure that a website ran smoothly. And of course, he automatically went on the defensive. And this is kind of weird for me because, like I said, I know the guy personally and he's not an Obama supporter. But he said, well, let's be really honest. They weren't the ones that built the website. No, but he's the damn president of the United States. The buck stops at his desk. I don't care who it was underneath him that decided that that company needed to be the one to build the website. It's ultimately his responsibility when the ish don't work. So let's just get real for a moment here. How much money have we wasted on a website that didn't work? Have any of you gotten your after Christmas surprise yet? When you were basically reminded that since you dropped out of the healthcare system last year and paid the fines that one, or that you were supposed to pay the fines but you didn't have to, that if you choose to do that again, you're now on year two fines, not year one fines. Oh, and if you don't opt out again, apparently you're going to be manually enrolled by the government and they're going to pick your plan for you. Oh yeah, this was a lovely idea. Can I take my parting gift now and go home? I'm ready to move to Canada. At least their socialized healthcare actually works. I mean, come on. Now, let's move on to college. Why is everything always got to be about college? You know how many, I mean, even at the grade school, junior high, and high school levels, why does everything have to be about college? Why can't we start spending more money on VOTEC programs and starting them even earlier? Why can we not do aptitude tests for children and realize the ones that are best, that best learn by working with their hands and start putting them in trade school programs earlier and earlier so that they can find the things that they want to do and the things that they're good at so they can stay engaged in school. So they not only get the book learning that they need, but they also learn a trade. And they have a job by the time they graduate from high school. And if they want to go even further and go into a trade school afterwards, they can make sure they make even more money at it, or they can go apprentice somewhere. Can we start actually trying to do things that work instead of blowing sunshine and lollipops and telling everybody if you keep voting Democrat, everything's going to be okay? Or, hey, you know, when the shoe's on the other foot, if you keep voting Republican, everything's going to be okay. I hate to tell you this, folks, at this point, we are now dealing with the Republican Party. Government has become this giant monstrosity, and we have seen the enemy. We are they are us. At this point, we are our own worst enemies because we are the ones that keep falling asleep at the switch and keep letting these idiots decide to tell us what it is that we need to do and how we need to do it when it's supposed to be the other way around. So can we just get real again for a second and just say exactly how it is? I don't want every person in this country going to college. All that does is drive the rates up. It makes it harder for the teachers that actually want to be there to teach, and they become professors that don't give a damn anymore because they've got 400,000 kids, not enough time to deal with any of them. Half of them don't want to be there. They're only going there because it's free. And let's face it, it's not free. It's no more free than the Affordable Health Care Act. Somebody's paying the bill. What are we going to do to pay for all of this stuff? We're going to do exactly what he said we were going to do last night, and we're going to put it on the backs of the top 1% that are already paying anywhere from 30 to 50% of the tax bill, state and federally, where dependent upon where they live. If you continue to tax these people into oblivion, they're going to take their toys, they're going to go home, and our government's not going to have any money. Because here's the thing, folks. They have the money to move. Do you? Can you pack up today if you wanted to and move to Europe? Can you pack up the day if you wanted to buy your own island and set up the Republic of STFU? Because a lot of these guys with money can. They can buy their own island, make it a country, put borders around the whole thing, and make a nice little white flag that says STFU, and just sit there. And be like, welcome to my country. The country is of STFU-a-thon, because you ain't messing with me no more. This is my money. I earned it. You leave me alone. This is the part nobody wants to think about when they start talking about the capital gains tax. We are a spending-based economy. Are we not? So that's how money gets made. People either invest it into firms that turn it into more money, which is good for the economy because it keeps all of those firms in business, and those people make money, and then eventually the people that invest their money make money. But how did they get that money? It was money that they likely worked for, which means it was taxed before they ever invested it. So we're taxing them once at upwards of probably around 30%, because if they've got the money to invest, then they're probably in the highest tax bracket. Then we're trying to coax them into investing the money so that our economy can stay afloat. But then we want to punish them when they decide they want the money that they invested in the first place because they made money off of the investment. Anybody want to say double dipping? Anybody? Anybody? Bueller? Bueller? Nobody, huh? Okay. I will. It's called double dipping. If you're going to punish the people that succeed, who then in turn reinvest to, one, not only make themselves a little bit more money off of the money they've already made and hopefully put aside a nest egg, but to also help fuel the economy, because let's face it, those people that invest, they don't invest all of it. They spend quite a bit. But they do invest some because they know that, hey, when you get to a certain point, you need to invest some money because that way you're covered should anything happen. And that's the way it should be done. But what are we doing? We're going to teach them that, hey, if you invest, we're going to tax you before you invest it. We're going to tax you after you invest it. So by the time it's all said and done, we're going to take 30% off the top before you invest. Then we're going to likely take another 30% off the top of whatever it is that you invested when your return on whatever you invested was probably close to 30 to 40% anyway. So, hey, all of that money that you just invested, hey, thanks. Uncle Sam's going to take that now. And we're going to put it into a damn fighter jet that China's going to hack and we're never going to be able to use. But thanks for playing. Would you like to see what's behind door number three? Wah, wah. Wow. Just saying, folks. It's the same stuff we see happen all the time. The people that already have enough, who run the government by telling you that don't have anything, hey, we can get more for you, never mind the fact that I'm one of the people that I'm going to exempt from everything that I'm telling you we're going to do to the rich people, because you can't know that I'm rich. There's no way I could possibly be rich and be telling you the things that I'm telling you. That wouldn't make any sense. How could I possibly be a rich guy? No, I'm not a rich guy. I'm a Democrat. I'm just like you. I'm blue collar. Bitch, you wouldn't know blue collar if it bit you in the ass. So can you just sit down and shut up now, please? You're up there behind a podium with a teleprompter and a manicure. And you're trying to talk to everybody like you're blue collar. You wouldn't know blue collar if it bit you. So please, just sit down. But again, back to the blue-collar folks. Why does everything always have to be about college? Let's put some investing into revamping the school system. We have middle school now in a lot of places. So let's end the normal education at about 7th grade and then make 8th and 9th grade kind of a place in the middle where they do some hands-on work, but it's not necessarily a vo-tech. And then they do some book work. And we do that by giving them aptitude tests. Let them find out the things that they like. Let them find out the things that they enjoy. Hell, I'm 42 years old. I didn't even know how much I was going to like this until I started it, and I didn't start this until 2 years ago. It's never too late to try something new. It's never too early to try something new either, because you may find something that you like and be able to turn it into not only a skill, but maybe a profession. If we didn't keep trying to bottleneck everybody into these damn academia places... College is not for everybody. We are not a one-size-fits-all nation. We never have been. We need to get away from that. Plain and simple. It's Speaking of a one-size-fits-all nation, this tax code bullcrap that he kept talking about, you know, where we're going to give you a tax credit, and we're going to do this, and we're going to do that. Okay, great, fine, that's all well and good. So basically what you're going to do is you're going to tax the rich to get some more money from them, then you're going to turn around and give it to the middle class. Here's an idea. Why don't you just rework the whole damn system? It's pretty simple. You institute a national sales tax. Let's say, just for the sake of argument, 10 cents on every dollar. You get rid of everything that has anything to do in our paychecks with everything other than anything that's attached to Social Security. The rest of it is all done through a sales tax. Let's say 10 cents on the dollar. Guess what? You've just basically removed the need for the IRS. How much money did we save, Bob? Now, not only that, here's where it gets good. With today's technology and the fact that everybody still has to file to show what they've made throughout the year so that we're able to track it as far as their income, you can take your previous year's earnings, and if you're below poverty level, whether you're single, family of four, family of 12, we don't care. If you're below poverty level, then you get this nice little card for the following year that anytime you go to the cash register, you swipe it, and you don't have to pay the sales tax. So now they're out of your paycheck if you're working legitimately, other than for the Social Security tax, which, God forbid, is the other biggest Ponzi scheme ever. At some point, we're definitely going to have to take a long, hard look at that one. But if you're below a certain income level, you don't have to pay the taxes. But it still works out really great, because the only way to verify that is if you have verifiable employment. If you're on the street corner pinching for cash and begging for money, then guess what? When you go buy whatever you're going to buy, you're going to be paying taxes too. So yes, please, by all means, take the $20 I just gave you because I felt sorry for you and go spend it on alcohol. I don't care. Because 10 cents of every dollar you just spent on alcohol is going to go into the food stamp program. It's going to go into the housing market program. It's going to go into all the other programs that we have. It's the only way to make it legitimately fair. Make it a flat rate that everybody pays, tie it to what they spend, and then everybody pays their fair share, which is an oxymoron, but it's the only way to make it work, because the more you spend, the more you pay, and there's not a bunch of friggin' loopholes. Why can we not do that? Why does that not make sense? Think of the money we would save. The technology's already there. Every single town keeps track of every single town and every single store in every single town keeps track of city sales tax rates. So the technology is already there. We make a modification to technology that already exists, and every time you spend money, that money goes to the federal treasury. You don't get it back. The only way you qualify to be able to get anything back is if you qualify for an exemption. To qualify for the exemption, you have to be able to swipe a card. To be able to qualify for the exemption, you have to have proven that in the last 12 months you were below a certain income level. How is this hard? Think of the money that would be pouring in if all of a sudden all of these people that were buying $1.5 million homes and $400,000 to $1.5 million cars were suddenly paying a 10-cent federal sales tax. If you really want to be able to hit the rich, which is what you guys say you want to do, let's do it the right way. Let's hit them for what they spend. Let's stop taxing what they invest. Let's hit them for what they spend. They're the ones buying all the luxury items. I don't give a crap what they invest, because their investing is giving other people jobs. They're investing in other companies is giving people jobs. They're investing in the stock market is giving people jobs. So why are we hitting them when they invest? Let's hit them when they spend. Let's hit everybody when they spend, unless they can prove that they're below a certain income level. I mean, come on, guys. I have an associate's degree and I can figure this crap out. What the hell? Sorry, a little frustrated. I kept listening to all this stuff over and over last night, and I really wish there was, like, a button you could press anytime you're tied into a live event that you could shock whoever was standing at a certain place to be like, no, you're lying again. Bzzz. No, you're not telling the truth again. Bzzz. Or no, you could fix it this way, you moron. Bzzz. I mean, come on. Wouldn't that make things like the State of the Union more entertaining? Or even presidential debates, for that matter? If you, the listener, could shock them every time you knew they were lying, would that not be fun? I'm just asking. Alright, so just to kind of bring things to a close, again, what we've been talking about tonight is the State of the Union and the fact that it basically, it sounded a lot like this. Alright folks, revisionist history not heard or seen since Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure. That is basically how I can sum up the State of the Union speech from last night. Revisionist history. Not only revisionist history, but the fact that he just basically took a bunch of ideas that weren't even his, took complete credit for them, and did victory lap after victory lap after victory lap. But that's okay, because I can look at the man and I can be honest, because I didn't vote for him. I didn't vote for him once, I didn't vote for him twice, and I didn't vote for him, and it has nothing to do with the color of his skin. It had everything to do with the content of his character. We didn't know who he was the day he took the national stage. What we do know now is he's a socialist. You don't believe me that he's a socialist? Let me remind you of a clip that we've played here a few times. But we are coming down to the close of the show, so I figure we might as well throw it at you one more time. Just because I know a lot of you are like, no, he's not really a socialist. He can't be a socialist. He's too much like Bush to be a socialist. So let's take out the show with a little bit of his own words saying exactly how much of a socialist he is.
I want to make a distinction between a universal plan versus a single payer plan, because those are two different things. A single payer plan would be a plan like Medicare for All, or the kind of plan that they have in Canada, where basically government is the only person is the only entity that pays for all health care. Everybody has a government paid for plan, even though depending on which country, the doctors are still private, or the hospitals might still be private. In some countries, the doctors work for the government and the hospitals are owned by the government. But the point is that government pays for everything, like Medicare for All. That is a single-payer plan. I have not said that I was a single-payer supporter because, frankly, we historically have had a employer-based system in this country with private insurers, and for us to transition to a system like that, I believe, would be too disruptive.
This is in public. So
how do we get the federal government to take care of its business? I happen to be a proponent of a single-payer universal health care plan. As you know, the reason why the United States of America, the wealthiest country in the history of the world, spending 14% of its gross national product on health care cannot provide basic health insurance to everybody.
I have not said that I was a single-payer supporter.
I happen to be a proponent of a single-payer universal health care plan.
It's amazing what the difference is in public to behind closed doors. Much like what happened with Mitt Romney in the speech that was videotaped that was around more of his fundraising crowd than the one that he gave in public, yet this president gets a pass. So let's just recap for all of you who are wondering just how much of a socialist this guy is. What are the things that he said? Well, one he's already done is the groundwork to basically destroy the insurance industry to make sure that the government has to step in to clean up the mess, which means at some point we will have socialized medicine, whether we want it or not, unless we do something to stop it. We brought the Republicans in to try to make sure that's going to happen. I hate to tell you, but since they are basically two halves of the same coin, I don't see that happening. But that was the plan, so that's what we tried to do. So then what does he bring to the table last night? Free community college. So now we're getting in, we're basically extending high school for 2 more years. To anybody who wants to go to community college, they'll foot the bill. Okay, well, does that mean they're going to have ultimate control over what the education is going to be at the community colleges? Well, you bet your bippy they are. Look at what they already do at the national level in the education programs up until high school. Now, then we have the fact that they want to get involved in some sort of nationalized healthcare system. Or not health, I'm sorry, childcare system. Again, take a really hard look at the Affordable Care Act and tell me that you want these folks any more involved in your education and any more involved in your childcare. I would have to say if I still had children of childcare age, my resounding, very loud, screaming at the top of my lungs answer would not only be a no, but a hell no. All right, that will do it for tonight's episode, folks. Again, this has been America Off the Rails. I am your host, Rowdy Ricky Robinson. We'll be back with you tomorrow night. Tomorrow night, we have live back-to-back programming. It'll be myself and then the grouchy one, a.k.a. the conservative curmudgeon, from 6 to 7 with me, 7 to 8 with him. And then we will roll right into the Voices of Global Freedom radio crew for about an hour and a half. Then we'll move right straight into Liz Harrison, slightly later than usual. And then, of course, for Friday, we will have me and then Bunny. And then I haven't figured out what I'm putting on after her yet, but we will play it by ear. And go from there. Now, as soon as this show ends, you'll be able to catch According to Me with host Jason DeWilkins. That is an original broadcast of 405 Radio. We do have authorization to syndicate it, however, so it does air with us every Wednesday from 7 to 8. Again, I am Rick Robinson, host of America Off the Rails and the programming director here at K98Talk.com. Just want to take just a moment to say thanks to everybody who's tuning in and making this one of the fastest growing political talk shows on the internet. So thanks to each of you that tune in every day. And again, don't forget, if you're not ever sure when I'm on, all you have to do is go to toptalkradio.com. They have me, sadly, with a real picture. Tried to get him to put up a fake one so I could look like, you know, somebody cool, but they made me give him a real picture. Has my schedule, tells you anytime I'm on, as long as it's tied to this RSS feed, it'll even light up and tell you when I'm live. So if you ever got a question about it, feel free to check us out on the website. You can go to the Facebook page, click like. We do have a K98Talk.com Facebook page. We also have America Off the Rails Facebook page. Got my personal Facebook page. You can hit me up there. Got my Twitter. Got my email. And I think what I'm going to start doing is just open up the phone lines on Fridays. I think because, you know, there's so much to pack into an hour show, 4 nights of the week. I don't really think I'm going to take too many callers. But Fridays, I'm going to give you guys a chance to, for those of you that have been listening for all 4 days, and if you've got anything you want to throw in there, we're going to open it up, bring everything back for the topics we talked about for actually, I guess, 5 days, Saturdays, because Saturdays kicks everything off. And give you guys a chance to just kind of talk about whatever you want to talk about during that hour. As we continue to grow, I don't know how much of that we're going to get to start, but we will definitely make that a recurring theme. So make sure you guys are checking that out and make sure you give us a call. All right, I'm going to go ahead and shut things down for the night. Again, here in just a second, you'll be able to hear According to Me with Jason DeWilkins. Then we'll be right straight into Liberty Unfiltered with our very own Steve Long right here at the Spark Radio Network on a show syndicated through Vigilant Liberty Radio. And I will be back with you tomorrow, folks. You have a good night. I'm not getting it. Looking to me, can you think it's true? I'm not getting it. I can see.